Hello aspirants, very warm welcome to Olive Board. So this is a session on management. And in this session on management, I'm going to talk about a very interesting topic. Right? Interesting why? Because we are going to talk about organizational behavior, which is generally a hot button area for RBI grade B. In fact, a lot of descriptive questions are also asked in this section. Okay. So we are going to talk about dimensions of personality and how they influence or how they shape organizational behavior. So without much of a further ado, let's begin. Yeah. So when you talk about dimensions of personality, traits. Now what are traits? Traits are permanent characteristics. Traits are relatively permanent characteristics. Traits are not, traits generally dot your behavior. They underscore your behavior. Like, many people have a quality of, like, for example, I have been told that I say right after almost every two or three sentences. In fact, if you play a game of having a tequila shot every time I say a right, then within 15 minutes it is said that you will be absolutely and adequately drunk. Right. So, I mean, jokes apart, but traits are those small little quirks about our behavior which generally are reflected in our daily life. Okay. Traits are not exactly character attributes, but those are characteristics of our personality, right? They make us very unique. And we have been, individuals have been seen to behave consistently across different situations if they have those traits. Like some people have a trait of flicking their fingers when they're excited, or sweaty palms when they are nervous, or even when some people have a tendency to react in a particular manner when they are under stress, or react in a particular manner when they are criticized. So those are the traits. They are relatively permanent, meaning they are not necessarily permanent. That means you can, if one, like I've been told a lot of things about my personality, and I've tried to change a few of those traits. Now that's also possible. Okay. So people can be compared by measuring some of the traits, and for that we have to understand what is introversion, extroversion, what is neuroticism, stability, and what is psychoticism. Now the reason I took up this topic and this part of this topic is because I want you to be absolutely familiar with these technical terms, because at the outset these terms may sound highly technical and may just scare away the candidate, and because of that you might not pick this up for studying. But at the end of the day, it's a very fairly simple topic. All it requires is a little bit of brainstorming, and then you are set to go. Okay. So let's begin with introversion, extroversion. What is introversion and what is extroversion? Now, we have many a times, and by now you must be familiar with the terms introvert and extrovert. Introvert is somebody who is shy and is a recluse, right? And an extrovert is a person who is socially very active and outgoing. But what do you understand by introversion and extroversion? As the name suggests, it's a bipolar trait. What do you understand by this? You understand that since it's a bipolar trait, elements of introversion are seen in the same person with elements of extroversion. So a person has a certain degree of introvertedness within them, and they have a certain degree of extrovertedness also embedded within their behavior. Right, you cannot, like, it is very difficult to find a person who's completely an introvert. There are such people, but then that is a rare species. There are many people who are extroverts, but there are very, I mean, who are extroverts along with being introverts. But there are very few people who are absolutely extroverts and who find it, I mean, who never get shy or who never feel the need to confine themselves to in their homes and in their rooms, right? So we are all introverts and extroverts to a certain degree, and therefore it is called as a bipolar trait. Maximum of us will exhibit and showcase these characteristics. So people with predominance of introversion are self-centered, and such people are idealistic, imaginative, shy, and secluded. Right? Obviously, we have known such people. Even if you are not a certified extrovert, you must have seen that in certain situations, you do act like an extrovert. Okay. Then that is the time when you feel shy. That is the time you want to seclude yourself. That is the time when you want to isolate yourself from the society. Right. Predominance of thoughtfulness steers them in the world of brooding, fantasy, and daydreaming. People who are introverts, they are very thoughtful. And because they are very perceptive, and because they like to wallow in their own thoughts, when they like to intermingle with their own thoughts, they are considered to be brooding. Brooding is somebody, a person who thinks, who evaluates, and who is silent. These people are also accused of fantasizing a lot, and these people are also accused of daydreaming a lot, right? Because obviously, when you are alone, obviously, there will be a tendency for you to daydream. There will be a tendency for you to build castles in the air. And all of us are accused of that. In fact, all of us are guilty of that, right? We all of us fantasize and daydream to a certain degree. But as an RBI grade B aspirant, you are expected to nullify or eliminate this aspect of fantasizing and daydreaming to a certain extent, because that will greatly ruin your chances of making it to the bank. Okay, so best hai ke, you know, you stick to the syllabus. Now, these people take considerable time in reaching decision and are worried about the future. There's a constant worry about the future. There's a constant level of apprehension regarding the future, right? These people are also considered or seen to be more skeptical. They are more apprehensive of life. Okay, so such people are very theoretical and often philosophers, poets, scientists, and professors. They could be philosophers. They can ask themselves, since I said I talked about the brooding aspect, they will deliberate on life and they will ask key questions regarding life. There are poets also, because fantasizing and daydreaming leads you to a very beautiful promised land where your thoughts are blossoming like flowers, where your thoughts can be conceived and designed and concocted and can be strewn around like a beautiful garland. And such people are seen to become poets, because obviously it's a romantic world where your thoughts are running free, running wild, right? But for that, you need to be alone, correct? That is a particular requirement. And therefore, you will see that people who are introverts are also, they will find themselves in the creative field, especially they will become poets. Scientists is because people who have the ability to lock themselves in a room have the tenacity and the tendency, both things. The attitude and the aptitude, both things, to carry out experiments. Look at Marie Curie. Look at Rutherford model. Look at Isaac Newton. Because these people were considered to be great introverts. They could lock themselves in a loop. Nikola Tesla. Nikola Tesla died a lonely death. Right? Karl Marx died a lonely, poor death. But these people have added to humanity. These people have added so much to our entire mankind that we are forever indebted to them. Aren't we? Of course we are. Right. Then, of course, they are professors, right? They are teachers. Professors is because a person who is an introvert is good at expressing and articulating his or her thought. That is seen. That is generally what we see from people who have a trait to be introverted. That they are, generally they won't speak, but when they speak, they make a pertinent point. So therefore, they will always make good professors, right? And extroverts, on the other hand, are more inclined to social activities. They are gregarious and they are social by nature. Of course, this is self-explanatory. And such people are realistic, practical, talkative, and active. Now, when you talk about extrovertedness is about having a worldview, going out, exposing yourself to the living conditions, and then forming a worldview. So when you go out, when you meet a lot of people, when you encounter a lot of situations, and when you find yourself in a lot of situations, what happens is that you become pragmatic, you become practical, you become realistic in life, because you know exactly what happens. You are no longer daydreaming or fantasizing. You are talkative also, because once you step outside of your home, it is very difficult to not talk, because when you are stepping outside of your house, when you are stepping outside of your cocoon, safe zone, then of course you have to engage with people. There is a certain level of social intercourse which is required of you, right? So therefore you will see that extroverts are generally very talkative people and they are socially very active, correct? They are very adventurous, they are travel savvy, and their entire demeanor actually spells out their attitude towards life. So they show more interest in leadership. Now, when you talk about a leader cannot be an introverted person. A leader can never be an introverted person, because a leader is expected to communicate. A leader is expected to make a vision statement and make a mission statement. A leader is expected to articulate his or her thoughts. And a leader is expected to reach out to his or her subjects. Right? And anybody who is not talkative, who is not an extrovert, will make for a bad leader. Now, I'll give you a great, great example. Now, when you talk about the current Prime Minister of India, Mr. Narendra Modi, he is considered to be a great orator. He is very good at articulating his thoughts. He is very good at reaching out to people. Now, unfortunately, the current political establishment has made a few errors and made a few mistakes in terms of the implementation and execution of policies. Like, for that matter, any other political establishment would make a mistake. Right? They made mistakes in terms of demonetization and GST. But look at the election results of 2019. BJP won with a thumping majority. And in fact, they won more than 300 seats, which was till now unforeseen, right? So how did that happen? Is because of leadership qualities, right, of Mr. Narendra Modi. So Narendra Modi exhibits a gregarious personality and is somebody who is talkative, who is approachable, and who can create a political narrative and a social discourse just by using his oration. Correct? So he's an extrovert. He steps out. I mean, he has the capability of doing so many rallies. On the other hand, you see Dr. Manmohan Singh. Now, Dr. Manmohan Singh was the Prime Minister of India for 10 years. And under the UAPA regime, there were so many achievements associated with them. Right. Eventually, their government crashed is because of their failure to rein in corruption. Because in UPA too, there was a lot of corruption. But otherwise, you see that the nuclear deal and the 8% and 9% consistent growth was during Dr. Manmohan Singh's tenure. But so he was a great executioner. He was a great economist. He is still a great economist, but he is a failed politician. Why? Because he could not speak. He could not communicate with the masses. And therefore, even after drafting a nuclear deal for India, which secured the energy future of India, in spite of that, he could not articulate that to the people. And as a result, in his second regime, people started losing faith in his party, right? So the biggest failure of Congress during that point in time was the inability of Dr. Manmohan Singh to appear as a leader. And the greatest achievement of BJP and its political achievement today is the fact that Narendra Modi is a great orator. So as a leader, you need to be articulate. You should be in a position to express yourself, right? Leadership requires that, correct? Therefore, you will always say that politically speaking, Narendra Modi is a huge success, correct? So having said that, very few people are completely extrovert or introvert, because as I said, everybody has a sense of extrovertedness and introvertedness embedded within them. Like, for example, I myself consider to have this bipolar trait. There are times when I just want to spend quality time with myself. I do not want to communicate even with my family. Right? I do not want to communicate even with my spouse. Those are the times when I want to just be by myself. So that is the time I am an introvert. But there are times when I am an extrovert also. Because I am socially active. Because I meet a lot of people and I feel the need to go out every once in a while and have a fine dining experience or have some indulge in some travel or engage in some adventurous activity. So I want to do that because that keeps my spirits up. So I would consider that I have this bipolar trait, and I'm sure that most of us have this, right? So we are extroverted and introverted in different degrees at different times. So it also depends on the context and the situation that we find ourselves in. Right, when relatives walk into our house, close relatives of our family or close relatives of our parents, whom we are not really familiar with, we suddenly withdraw into our shell. Why? Because at that point in time, we are introverted because we do not know how to communicate with them because we are not really familiar with them. Whereas our parents had probably spent their childhood with them, so they are more familiar with them. Right. On the other hand, if your friends visit your house on your birthday party, you will be very extroverted because you have spent your childhood with them and therefore you will find it very comfortable to speak with them. So depending on the situation, depending on the mood that we are in, because mood also plays an important role, right? We will become introverted and extroverted, right? So I would say that majority of the people fall in this bracket. That means all of us to a certain degree exhibit some degree of introversion and some degree of extroversion in our behavior, and hence we are called as ambiverts. Okay. Now there is something called as neuroticism stability dimension. Now this neuroticism stability dimension is also a bipolar dimension. People who are high on neuroticism exhibit particular traits and behavioral tendencies. They show lack of emotional control and willpower with an added characteristic of slowness in thought process and inactivity. Now, there are so many people, right? There are many people who are emotionally very fragile or emotionally very insecure, right? And I'm sure that all of us have that one person in our lives, or have at least one person in our lives, or we may have had that one person in our lives in the past who was emotionally very, very fragile, who did not have control over their emotions, and therefore they will break into a tear, or they will break down, or they will become very edgy, they will become very angry, they will become very anxious, they will show signs of depression, they will show signs of desperation, they will want your attention. There are such people, and they have very less willpower. If they want to consume something, there are people, alcoholics, they do not have enough willpower to not have alcohol, right? People who want to have a lot of food and smoking, all of these things, they do not have control, right? Why? Because of their emotional incapacity, they want to compensate that with developing an addiction, right? So there are people who show lack of emotional control and willpower with an added characteristic of slowness in thought process and activity. And even small things perturb them. Small things, very small things will always, will always make a dent on their psyche. So people with high neuroticism are high on suggestibility and low on sociability, right? They are not really very sociable. And even if they are, they magnificently fail in that particular endeavor. So such people are also characterized by increased emotional impulsiveness. They will take quick decisions based on whether they are angry, whether they are happy, and so on and so forth, right? On the other hand, you may have come across people who maintain their composure even during stressful times. People who know their emotional groundings and emotional foundation, and they do not get easily disturbed or perturbed even when they are confronted with conflicting issues. They have the ability to absorb pressure. They have the ability to exhibit tenacity of mind. Such people are great to hang out with, and such people are great to work within an organization because they can soak up the pressure and they will ensure that their performance does not suffer. Why? Because they have a complete control over their emotion and they are not emotionally impulsive, right? So, like how it is said in Gita also, right? The Gita, which is, I'm referring to Mahabharata, okay? So when you say in Gita, the crux of Gita includes that you need to be detached and attached at the same time. If you want to achieve your goal, for example, your goal right now is to crack RBI grade B exam, correct? Now, if you want to achieve that goal, correct? You perhaps need to attach yourself to the syllabus. You need to go through olive board lectures, or for that matter, lectures by any other faculty or any other organization. You need to attend tests. So you need to be completely attached, but you need to be detached also at the same time. Why? Because too much of attachment may also lead to anxiety, nervousness, right? Aray, aaj exam diya, bahut kam marks hai, kaise hoga? Then you will fret over it. You will think about it throughout the night. You will lose your sleep on that, and perhaps the next day you'll wake up very disturbed, right? So you need to detach also yourself from the situations. And at times, see, when you are now, since you are in such a competitive atmosphere, you're expected to crack this exam. Now, these are the times when you cannot become very, very emotional. You are at an age where you are probably dating somebody. There are girls who have boyfriends, and probably there are boys who have girlfriends, right? And probably, girls also have girlfriends these days, and boys also have boyfriends these days. So everything is possible. What we suggest to our students is that even if you are in a relationship right now, you need to detach yourself to the extent that you respect the person, but at the same time, you do not let small bickerings and small fights actually affect your larger goal and your process, because process is sacred and process cannot be compromised. This process, this timetable that you have, it cannot be renegotiated. It cannot be compromised, and no amount of emotional instability can affect that. So for that, what do you have to do? You have to detach yourself at a level. I'm not saying that you have to become completely cold-hearted. No, but a certain level of detachment is allowed, is expected. Okay. So within an organization, some people exhibit neuroticism stability dimension also, which is a bipolar dimension, right? Then there is a psychoticism dimension. What do you understand by psychoticism dimension? People with this trait show lack of concentration, power, and weak memory. And they are also characterized by insensitivity. That means they are completely ignorant to everybody else's aims, ambitions, feelings, and considerations. All they are concerned about is themselves, right? So they are considered to be absolutely selfish and self-centered, right? To the extent that they appear to be cruel also at times. The best example of that would be perhaps somebody who is addicted to alcohol but wants to be in a relationship. Or one of the good examples of that would be Emperor Aurangzeb. Aurangzeb was seen to exhibit this trait, particular trait of psychoticism dimension, wherein he appeared to be very cruel. All he cared was about himself and how he wanted to become the greatest Mughal emperor to have ruled India, to the extent that he also imprisoned his own father and killed his own brothers. What does that tell you about Aurangzeb? That he was a psychotic fellow also, at an individual or at a personal level. One cannot deny that fact, right? So and at the end of the day, what happened? That particular tendency of his led to his own downfall. So he was unable to protect himself from the incoming dangers, especially from the Maratha Empire, right? So there was an element of psychoticism also as regards Aurangzeb is concerned. Now these are the three dimensions: introversion, extroversion, neuroticism stability dimension, and psychoticism dimension, which are seen within an organization, which are exhibited by individuals within an organization. Okay. Now, motivation. Psychologists widely believe that for a person to engage in some particular behavior, the presence of motivation is a must. And who better than an RBI grade B aspirant to understand that? In such a highly competitive atmosphere, you are expected, I mean, motivation is the crux. If you really want to win, then, and if you really want to win at all costs, motivation, there has to be a driving force. Motivation is like the fuel which will drive your entire growth process, right? If you want to lose weight, if you want to have a great physique, if you want to crack an All India exam, if you want to participate in athletics, if you want to excel in sports, if you want to write a book, if you want to crack UPSC, whatever it is, motivation is always required. So this dimension of personality includes all those motivational activities which, while directing a person towards a target, give rise to specific patterns of behavior. Now the best example of that would be somebody like Michael Jordan. If you have seen the documentary The Last Dance on Netflix. Now Michael Jordan is somebody who is highly motivated. He is single-minded about achieving his goals and is single-minded about becoming great on the basketball court, right? Now, because he is motivated, he exhibits certain specific patterns of behavior. Because he is motivated, he is sometimes seen to be less, he is sometimes seen to be aloof. He is sometimes seen to be ignorant of others' feelings. Sometimes he is seen to be too hard on himself. He cannot tolerate any level of underperformance even during a practice game. So he becomes very hard on himself, right? He is very tenacious. He will never give up. Right, even at 9 o'clock in the night, he will appear on the court and he will be there on the court till he gets it right. So there are some character attributes or behavioral patterns that will associate with a highly motivated individual. A highly motivated individual never gives up. A never say die attitude can always be associated with somebody who is very, very motivated. Right, and motivated people also have the ability to get up. Right, because see, success does not come unless you have failed a lot. Right, what we see is success, but success is like a tip of the iceberg, and the iceberg, as geography suggests, is 10 times more in volume and density beneath the water, and all of us know that, correct? So motivation, highly motivated individuals, they will exhibit success, but only after losing so much. So when they lose, when they fail, they have the ability to get up, right? So this ability to bounce back, this ability to fight back, is associated with people who are greatly motivated. Temperament. Now, temperament is the third main dimension of personality. And what is temperament? It is the sum total of emotional and affective tendencies of the person. Everybody is emotional, but emotional management does not come naturally to everyone. People who are highly sensitive, who show a high level of irritability, who exhibit a high levels of nervousness, and people who cannot, who find it difficult to be pleasant, are considered to be bad when it comes to temperament. And people who can manage all these are considered to be people who can manage their temperament, right? So temperament is believed to be the innate quality of a person. That means it is present at the time of the birth. Right, many people are seen to have showcased this quality throughout their lifetime. You either are game ready or you are not game ready. There are many people who, in spite of so much of struggle, pain and hard work and talent, also will fail. And there are many people who are just simply tenacious, who have the right temperament for exam situation, for a game situation. So they will always bring their A game to the situation, right? So those, the such kind of people are considered to have a great temperament for a pressure crunching situation. Right. Now, character. What do you understand by character? By character, we are referring to moral excellences. Right. That means integrity, honesty, dignity. Correct. These are the character traits which will signify whether you are a morally correct person or whether you are an immoral person. Correct. So character involves, if you want to build up a character, then you should deliver on what you promise. If you want to build up on your character, you should definitely do what you have promised. You should definitely be honest. You should be disciplined. You should be dignified. You should exhibit integrity. Correct? So building a character is a long process, and that has to be cultivated. And if at all in our lives, at many times we have been immoral, but we always get a chance to correct our behavior. So course correction is also associated with character formation. Character formation, like Jesse, for example, we know Angulimal was a a robber or a devil. But when he came in touch with Buddha, he became a saint. Correct. So he changed his character. Ashoka was a great emperor, but Ashoka became the greatest apostle of peace after the Kalinga War. So Ashoka also changed his character. Correct. So it is a learned aspect of personality. You learn it, you cultivate it, you nurture it, and it is acquired through a process of socialization. In fact, the change of heart of Emperor Ashoka also happened after a process of socialization. After that great Kalinga War, after having come in contact with Buddhist monks, then after that point in time, Ashoka changed, right? Gandhiji was not born as Gandhiji, right? He was born as a normal individual who wanted to pursue his law. But after the process of socialization, he started thinking for the future of India. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar was born in a Dalit family, right? But after a process of socialization, after having gone to London School of Economics and Columbia University, he became socialized and he cultivated a character to the extent that in a country where he was considered as an untouchable, he wrote the entire constitution of that country, right? So anything is possible if you build up character. But character cultivation is a learned process. You have to learn to cultivate that character. And that should be embedded within your conscience. Your conscience. If your conscience doesn't allow anything, then you won't do it. And if your conscience allows to commit an immoral act also, and if you do it, then one can see that you lack character. Correct. Right. For example, integrity. What is integrity? Integrity is doing the right thing when nobody is watching. Means what? Means that you're walking and you have seen somebody lose their or drop their phone. Correct. Now, nobody has seen that and that person has also walked away. Nobody knows. You pick up the phone. Nobody has seen you pick up the phone also. Now, nobody has seen. Even if you keep that phone with you, nobody can accuse you of stealing that phone. Because technically, it is not stealing. It is somebody who lost their phone. Integrity is when you call that person and tell them that, look, or you find out that person through their call logs and tell them or call their friends or mother or father to collect their phone from you. So, integrity is what? Doing the right thing when nobody is watching. And it is through these actions, it is through these traits, you build up a character. Okay. So with this, we come to the end of this session. I hope this was beneficial for you. Right. In the next sessions, we will be talking about more aspects of management. So till the time we meet next, this is Rohan Dange signing off from Olive Board. Thank you. Take care.